Hello, everybody. My name is Igor. I'm a software engineer on a mission to help build a better web. You might know me from Angular, where I spent a good decade building the framework. But then about 2.5 years ago, I joined Cloudflare to focus on the server side because I think most of the new breakthroughs that will help web will actually come from the server side. Patak and I and our teams have started collaborating about a year ago, and we built some really cool things, and I'm excited to show you some of that today. As I was preparing this presentation, I started thinking about what should I call it? What is the presentation going to be called? And I even told Patak, I'm going to call it Building Decentralized Web Applications with Vite. But as I was doing the final preparations and slides and whatnot, I realized that decentralized is not quite the right name. I thought about this more, I did more research, and I landed on this new thing called Web Polyliths. It's kind of a mouthful, please bear with me, I'll explain where it's coming from. And if you have new ideas for a better name, please shoot me an email, I'll consider it. But Web Polyliths is a way to break away from the current era of web monoliths. This is how we're building applications today. And this using monoliths to build applications has some downsides, and I think we can do better. And this presentation is about how we can do better. So polylithic web applications, what the heck? Like, this sounds totally made up. Is it made up? Well, yes and no. So I was doing the research. I was looking for a word that would describe something that is opposite to monolithic. And I came across a lot of research in geology. And there I found this polylithic definition where I found that it's defined as consisting of many stones, of many building blocks. It's the opposite of monolithic. I was like, yeah, that's it. This is exactly what I want, because polylithic applications are exactly the opposite of monoliths. They are made up of many pieces. These pieces operate in sometimes decentralized way, and this is where it's like where decentralized came to be. But I think like what I realized is decentralized often means that it's the control, it's the operator that is decentralized, that you have many parties operating the application. And that's not quite what I'm after, even though like decentralization is often a good thing. The term is not fully made up, but it's also not very common yet. We'll see if it takes off. I hope it does. So before we go to polylithic applications, let's talk about monolithic applications, the applications of today. This is how we build applications. Most of our applications are monolithic. They have only single entry point. That's the code that bootstraps the application or responds to the request. This entry point often can be bundled. Bundling is optional. It doesn't have to, it's not a required part to be a monolithic application. And if you do bundle, you don't need to end up with a single file. You can still use lazy loading and end up with many chunks. But the point is that there is a single entry point, and from the point of like traversing the AST, the dependency graph of all the symbols in the application, there is really just like one universe of all the code. And this code is loaded into single JavaScript context, and that's how the application operates. Now, examples of monolithic applications, the most common one is SPA, single page applications. All of us have built some. But also Node.js. Node.js, most of the Node.js applications, unless you're using some of the advanced APIs like child process or VM module, your application is most likely monolithic, even if it's not bundled. Dino, the same thing. Again, unless you're doing something advanced, you're most likely building a monolithic application. And the same applies to Cloudflare Workers, which is interesting because we have this very nimble runtime that is deployed to 400 cities around the world. And people still build these bigger monolithic applications and deploy to them. Works, but we could do better. We'll talk about it soon. So what are the benefits of monolithic applications? Because there must be some, otherwise we would not be building these applications in this way. And the truth is that the main benefit is that they are simple. And simplicity is often such a key property, and we value it so highly that any other benefits or any other the disadvantages are secondary. Like we're already overwhelmed with a lot of complexity in our lives. So if there is a simple solution, then we'll just go for it. And that's the case with monolithic applications, I believe. But there are also some cons, some negatives about monolithic applications. They tend to be slow in two ways. One is that they often load more JavaScript than they need into the runtime, both on server side or client side. This slows down the initial interactivity impacts both server-side and client-side, but also they're slow because they can't take advantage of multi-threading. JavaScript is single-threaded. If you have a monolithic application and executes in a single JavaScript context, it cannot do more than one piece of work at a time. Monolithic applications are also inefficient, and efficiencies often come down to how they are deployed and operated. If you have a monolithic application, but that application talks to multiple data stores and those data stores are not centralized, then you often end up paying more latency when talking to these data stores because you cannot be in all the locations at the same time, which is not the case if you were to break up the application, in which case the individual compute units could run closer to the data. They're also less secure, and this is because all of the code runs in a single JavaScript context, and the JavaScript context shares some global state. So if intruder were to inject their codes in some way, maybe through a third-party dependency, that intruder now has access to everything that is available in that JavaScript context, as long as it's traversable. And this is not great because from the like perimeter and blast radius perspective, the blast radius is basically an entire application. Not good. The other property that I care about a lot is also fragile. Monolithic applications tend to be fragile, especially as they grow, because the more code you have, the higher the chance of some kind of collision, race condition, some kind of interaction between various parts of the code base that are hard to reason about and hard to debug, and eventually the application just becomes very troublesome to iterate on and debug and understand. So obviously polylithic applications solve all of these problems, right? Because otherwise we wouldn't be talking about them. But what are the trade-offs? Because there must be some trade-offs. However, before we jump there and talk about the trade-offs, let's talk about some surprises. Because I think most of you will be surprised to hear that all of you have already built some polylithic application already, and you maybe don't know it yet. This is because polylithic applications can be defined as applications that have two or more entry points. They have two that can be bundled into two or more bundles. They run in multiple isolated JavaScript contexts, one for each of the entry points or bundles. And good examples of these applications are full-stack applications. And this is where I think many of you have built some. Full-stack applications have a client-side and server-side program. These are bundled independently, loaded into two separate JavaScript contexts, one on the client-side, one on the server-side, and it's all handled by some kind of framework, typically. So I bet many of you have built polylithic applications. Another good use case is web worker. With web worker, the code running in a web worker is often in distinct independent program, and most of us have used web worker in one way or another. Service worker, very similar story. Edge middleware, again, very similar. It's a distinct program that runs at the edge near the user. And very commonly these days we talk about RSCs, and RSCs are yet another good example of polylithic application where they are bundled, the React server components are bundled separately. They have their own entry point that they run in their own JavaScript context. So polylithic applications are becoming more and more common, but they're not the mainstream. It's not how we build applications these days. And if we were to build them in this way, we would get lots of benefits. They would be faster, because often these programs are much smaller. They don't have problems with cold start latency. They can take advantage of multiple threads. They are more efficient because you can deploy them into various locations close to data, reducing the overall latency. They're more secure because the perimeter of the attack radius is the individual program, which is much smaller than the entire application. So if an attacker were to intrude into part of the application, it's not the entire application that is compromised. And also it's much more robust because if you have smaller chunks, it's much easier to understand the application. You can look at one part of the application in isolation from the rest and fully understand it. So it's much easier to understand, iterate, fix, and so on. However, there is no free lunch, because if there was no downside, then everybody would be building applications in this way. However, the downside is complexity. And the complexity comes in several forms. It's configuration complexity, build complexity, deployment complexity. There's lots of them. And this complexity can be overwhelming. However, as I mentioned, we've been already building some of these polylithic applications all along. So how is that possible? Let's take a look at a very simple case with a web worker. We have a main program that runs in the main thread and does all of DOM manipulation. Then we have a web worker. In this case, we have two programs that are composed into one application. They can be bundled into two bundles. These bundles are in two distinct JavaScript contexts. And often we build them in a single source code because you can have just a single Git repository to collocate all this code and work on it in one go. So before all of this was possible, it was possible to build these applications, but it was tricky. And the way we did it was we had all kinds of like custom builds using rollup or ESBuild. We would rely on frameworks to abstract away the complexity. Most of the full stack frameworks do this behind the scenes. Then they just produce the client side and JavaScript, client side and server side bundles for you. But there are also npm packages that have been built for consumption in this way. For example, some libraries that are meant to be used in a web worker context or service worker context, you just load them in a way where it just creates a new web worker and then you talk to it and you don't really even know that that is happening. So all of this was possible, but it was limiting, and it is possible for it to get messy very quickly, just like this bunch of cables that I found online. This is not what we want. So Vite 6 changes all of this. Vite 6 comes with Environment API. Environment API is a very powerful API that allows us to build polylithic applications. So what does it do? It allows you to create many environments. So before Vite 6, Vite 5, imagine that you basically had just one environment. In Vite 6, you can have arbitrary number of environments. Each environment can support a separate program. This program gets its own configuration, loaders, transformers, and even JavaScript runtime. And this is why our team was involved in helping the Vite team build this feature, because we want to be able to use Vite, and we want our developers to be able to use Vite and run the code that is produced by Vite in our JavaScript runtime that Cloudflare makes called Cloudflare Workers or WorkerD. And Environment API allows that. If you build an environment this way, you don't sacrifice any of the developer benefits. You get HMR, you get debugging, you get source mapping support, and all of the developer experience benefits that you're expecting from Vite. So obviously this polylithic web applications solve many problems that we have and have a wide range of application. It would be good if we could just take a quick look at some of the examples where we might want to take advantage of them. So I mentioned the web worker and the service worker scenario. In this case, Vite can create three environments with three different configurations, support HMR for all of these. And as a developer, you're just starting with one Vite server, not realizing that all of this is happening behind the scenes. But you can now build the application just like it will be deployed to production, which is very powerful. The same is true for the server side. You can have a three-tier server-side application with SSR backend and REST backend, and Vite can handle that. Again, three collaborating programs. You can build applications with Edge middleware and SSR backend. As I mentioned, Astro before. Astro supports this kind of configuration, very powerful. Vite supports it. And you can combine all of these and just go crazy and create basically as many environments as you want if your application requires it. So with Vite 6, you can get all of the benefits of polylithic web applications without the downsides of the complexity, because the complexity will be abstracted away by Vite itself. But let's take a look at the demo. I was thinking what to demo, and originally I thought I was going to show you Remix or SvelteKit or Quick, because we're working on integrations between all of these and Vite 6 and Cloudflare. But last week, one of my teammates, James Opstad, came to a meeting and was like, "Hey, I want to show you something cool. I built a prototype of what building Cloudflare workers with Vite natively could look like eventually in the future." And I was like, well, let's see. The actual application is very simple. I'm just making a curl request to Vite server. The Vite server then talks to two workers that are running in worker D in the virtual machine in a JavaScript runtime that powers Cloudflare workers. Vite builds and bundles this and has an HMR client running in all of the, both of these contexts. So as we change code, we are able to reload worker A or worker D, depending on which one changed. And all of this is abstracted away, so as a developer, you don't really see that this is happening. So we have two programs that are collaborating and working together. Let's jump into an editor here and take a look at what that looks like. So the code itself is very simple. I'll link to GitHub in a bit. The main part is ViteConfig. In ViteConfig, we are pulling in this plugin, which is experimental plugin. Don't use this in production. This is just for demo purposes, exploratory purposes. But the cool thing is that we have the Cloudflare plugin that defines two environments. In these environments, we have worker A and we have worker B. Both of them have this main property that defines an entry point and then a config file that is just a very simple config file. The config file actually is almost empty, doesn't do much. In case of worker A, we're just saying that, hey, this is how we could hold of worker B so you can talk to it. Now, if we take a look at the index file, the code itself is super simple. We have a fetch handler that gets hold of worker B, calls this function called a method called name, gets the result, and uses that to produce a response that is returned. Worker B, on the other hand, is even simpler because it's a class that has a name method that just returns a string. That's all. So if I go and I start my Vite server and I curl it, I get this response back. Now let's run this in a loop so that we see as it updates. If I go here and change this, let's say I just want a longer version of this year, we see that Vite reloaded. That caused HMR reload in the worker D runtime of affecting worker B. And now we see that the year is updated. So if I don't like the year at all, let's say, let's remove it. The same applies here. We can go and just add more hearts because everybody needs more hearts these days. And we see that Vite rebundles the application, updates the worker D runtime with the new code. And then as we make this next request, the response updates. Super simple, very powerful, because as a developer, I don't need to think about managing all of these VMs, managing the transpilation, build pipeline, and so on and so on. So let's jump back. Here's the link. You'll have a link to slides later, so don't worry about grabbing it now. But do me a favor and go build some polyliths. I think it's time to say goodbye to monoliths. I think we can do better. I think the whole web, both the developers as well as users, will be better off if we stop building monolithic applications and switch over to polyliths. And you can use Vite 6 to do that because Vite 6 makes it so easy. With that, I just want to thank you all. I want to thank Vite and Vite team and Patak for great collaboration. And yeah, see you out there. Bye.